Greetings for the day. I am Dr. Mamta, Professor, Department of Pharmacognosy, KLE College of Pharmacy, Bangalore. Can you guess what is this? Yes, you are right. This is ginger, and all of you have guessed it right because this is very commonly seen in everyone's kitchen. So today we will be learning pharmacognosy of ginger. Ginger is one of the secondary metabolites which belongs to resins. So by the end of this session, you'll be learning about the following: synonyms of ginger, its biological source, geographical source, cultivation, collection and storage of ginger, morphology, microscopy, chemical constituents of ginger, its uses, substitutes, adulterants and commercial products of ginger. To begin with the pharmacognostic scheme of ginger, its synonyms are Rhizoma zingiberis, zingiber, shunti, adrak and many more. Now let's know the biological source of ginger. Now ginger consists of whole of cut, dried, scrubbed or unscrubbed rhizomes of zingiber officinale belonging to family Zingiberaceae, and it contains not less than 0.8% of total gingerols on dried basis. Now when I tell biological source, it means it consists of four different parts. The first is it talks about the part which is important. Secondly, it will talk about the nature of that part, whether it is scrapped or unscrapped. Next, it talks about the botanical name. So here it is Zingiber officinale, where Zingiber is the genus and officinale is the species. Next, it talks about the family which it belongs to, that is Zingiberaceae. And not less than 0.8% of total gingerols, this is nothing but the amount of active constituent which has to be present. So all these details are covered under biological source. So let me just repeat. Biological source, ginger consists of whole of cut, dried, scrapped or unscrapped rhizomes of Zingiber officinale belong to family Zingiberaceae, and it contains not less than 0.8% of total gingerols on dried basis. Now coming to geographical source of ginger. So it is indigenous to Southeast Asia, that is it is native of Southeast Asia. It is also cultivated in Caribbean islands. It is seen in Mauritius, Australia, Jamaica, Taiwan, Africa and India. And also main cultivation takes place in West Indies, Nigeria, Jamaica, India, Japan and Africa. More than 35% is produced in India itself. Now coming to the cultivation, collection and storage of ginger. So ginger plant is a perennial herb. It grows to 1 meter height, and this plant is cultivated at an altitude of 600 to 1500 meter above sea level, and it requires a well-drained, rich, loamy soil and abundant rainfall. So usually the cultivation path goes like this. Rhizome is cut into small pieces called fingers. So each rhizome is cut into small pieces called fingers, and each finger consists of a bud. So this is the bud. This is placed in a hole which is filled with manure. So during the month of March, April, fingers like this are placed inside the mud. These rhizomes, they get matured in the months of December to January, and by January the plants wither after flowering. Then the flowers are basically forked up. Now how do you collect it? So buds and the roots are removed. They are washed to remove all the mud and clay which is attached to them, and the rhizomes are soaked in water overnight. Next morning, the rhizomes are scraped with a knife to remove the outer cork layer and a little of parenchyma. So usually for storage purpose this is done. The outer cork is scraped off and a little bit of parenchyma is removed. It's washed again and again dried under sun for a week. So thorough drying is ensured. Now this is called as unbleached Jamaica or the uncoated ginger. So to prolong its shelf life, you can also coat ginger so that its shelf life or its stability exceeds, and this can be stored for longer period of time. So how do we go about? It's prepared by dropping the rhizome for few minutes in boiling water. The skin of the rhizome is removed such that the layer on the flat surface comes out, but not in the grooves between the branches. And now this is bleached. It is treated with sulfuric acid, chlorine, or it is dusted with calcium sulfate or calcium carbonate. So basically it is bleached, or a coating is done by using calcium sulfate or calcium carbonate, and this is called as bleached or limed ginger. Now this can be stored for a longer period of time. Just now we'll go to the next parameter, most important one. So we'll discuss about the morphology of ginger. Now when it comes to morphology, basically we'll be studying on a set of parameters. So morphological evaluation is also called as microscopic evaluation. It's also called as sensory evaluation or organoleptic evaluation, because these evaluations are done using your sense organs. Okay, so there's a particular scheme for this also. We usually study it as color, odor, taste, shape, size and extra features. Okay, now coming to the color of ginger, so it is buff in color. Odor, it is agreeable, so you accept that taste. And it is aromatic, it has got a pleasant smell. So anything which is aromatic definitely will be having volatile oil also as one of the component. And taste, again it is agreeable, so you can accept that taste. And it is pungent, so directly if you eat it, you feel it is a little spicier. And size, so when you measure the rhizome with the help of scale, so usually this is irregular. So it can vary from 5 to 15 centimeter in length and 1.5 to 6.5 centimeter in breadth. And the shape is, these rhizomes are laterally compressed, okay? And next, coming to the extra features. So rhizomes have short, flat, ovate and oblique branches on the upper side. And you can observe the bud at the apex. Fracture, that is if you break it, it is short and fibrous. You can see the fibers extending. And longitudinal striations are easily observed. Nodes and internodes can be seen. And next, when we study the transverse section, we can observe the endodermis and steel in that. Now, let me just again brief you the morphology. So, color. I told you this buff in color. So, you can see the buff color here. And odor. When you smell it, it is agreeable and it is aromatic. So, you taste it. It is agreeable and pungent. Size, measure it. Length is usually 5 to 15 centimeter, can vary. And the breadth is 1.5 to 6.5. So if I see this, this is somewhere around 7.5 centimeter and it has got a breadth of around 2 to 2.5 centimeter. And shape, usually these rhizomes are laterally compressed. Now after the laterally compressed shape, we can go to the extra features. So you can see the internodes. Internodes is nothing but space between nodes. So you can see the nodes, you can see the internodes, scaly leaf, you can see the bud at the apex and some adventitious roots. And further, these rhizomes, you can see that they have short, flat, ovate and oblique branches on the upper side. So branches are seen. Then this is the bud at the apex. Fracture. So if you break it, see, it is fibrous and it is short. So it easily breaks and you can see these fibers which are protruding. So this is called as fibrous fracture. And also you can observe longitudinal striations. These are nothing but the lines on the ginger. Now coming to the next parameter, that is microscopic evaluation. So here what we usually do, we take the rhizome, we just cut it into a small piece and then take the transverse section of it with the help of blade. So like this, about 50 to 100 sections are taken. From this, best 30 or 40 good ones are picked onto a watch glass. Then we'll be treating it with chloral hydrate, boiling it for some time so that the cells get cleared. Further, this can be treated with fluoroglucinol and concentrated HCl. And from this, the best sections of it can be selected and put on the slide and observed under microscope. So usually we observe under 10x. Now when you observe such type of section, what are the important cells we observe? So cork is seen, and this cork consists of irregularly arranged cells. There is no particular pattern, and cork is absent in Jamaican ginger. Next, phallogen is seen, so this is indistinct. After this layer, we can observe cortex. Now cortex consists of thin walled cellulosic rounded parenchyma with intercellular spaces. So what does this mean? We can observe parenchyma cells which has intercellular spaces between them, and these parenchyma cells are thin walled. They also contain simple ovate or sac shaped starch grains with hilum at the pointed end. So what basically, if you have to just look, observe starch grains, section can be taken, and to this if you add diiodine, you can observe simple ovate or sac shaped starch grains. The simple means single starch grains can be observed with hilum at the pointed end. And it also contains closed collateral fibrovascular bundle. That means the xylem and phloem is in combination with the fibers. So we can see closed collateral type of fibrovascular bundles in this. Next, endodermis. This one is the most important feature. Now you can see it as a distinct single line. So if you just observe this, you can easily identify that the given sample is if you observe endodermis, that means you can easily identify that it is a ginger. So this is distinct. It consists of tangentially elongated cells which contain suberin in the radial wall. So suberin thickenings will be there. So even when you are drawing the TS of ginger, where endodermis is present, you are going to make it thicker. And here in endodermis, starch is absent. Next we will see steel. The lower part of the TS will show steel, which consists of ring of vascular bundle, and here fibers are not present, and this is present below the endodermis. So first we see the cork, then we see the cortex, then endodermis and steel. So let us discuss about these things by looking at the transverse section diagram of ginger. So you have heard about the discussion. Let us see it in the transverse section diagram. You can see the outer cork here, which is irregular in shape. Then you can see the inner cork. Finally, the cortex below it. Then starch grains. So simple starch grains, which you have hilum as a pointed end. Then you can see the fibrovascular bundles. So xylem and phloem is associated with fibrovascular bundles. Then a layer of endodermis is seen. And oleoresin, like brownish pigments, you can see the oleoresin present in this particular TS. So these are the most important features in transverse section of ginger rhizome. Coming to the chemical constituents. So ginger, basically it's an oleoresin. Oleoresin means oleo is oil and resin. So it has both combination of oleo and resin. So about 1 to 4% of volatile oil is present. In volatile oil, basically it consists of monoterpene hydrocarbons, sesquiterpene hydrocarbons, oxygenated mono and sesquiterpenes, and phenyl propanoids. So you very well know what are monoterpenes. So terpenes are the building blocks of volatile oil. Monoterpene will have a molecular formula of C10H16, that is C5H8 taken 2 times, and we very well know volatile oil is made up of isoprene unit, that is C5H8 units. Sesquiterpene, it is C5H8 taken 3 times, and it also has oxygenated mono and sesquiterpenes. So now here, oxygenated terpenes are called as terpenoids, and along with it, it also has phenyl propanoids. So sesquiterpene hydrocarbons are present, alpha zingiberine, alpha curcumin, beta sesquiphylandrine. All these are some of the major constituents present in ginger. And the smell, okay, so whatever volatile smell we get, it is because of the volatile oil component present in ginger. And the flavor, the taste and pungency, and the pharmacological action is basically because of the phenolic ketones of the oleoresin, mainly gingerols, sugars, and gingerol. Now, if I have to brief you, it basically contains resins and volatile oil. Aroma is because of volatile oil, and the flavor, pungency, and pharmacological activity is basically because of this phenolic ketone of oleoresin, like gingerols, sugars, and gingerol. So this is the structure of zingiberine, which is a volatile principle. This is gingerol and sugar, which is the resinous portion mainly responsible for flavor and pungency. Next one, let's come to the uses of ginger. So ginger is most widely used. It is used as anti-emetic, reduces vomiting. It's a positive inotropic, it acts on muscles. It's a spasmolytic, it reduces spasms. It's a stomachic, it increases the secretions in the stomach and makes you feel hungrier. So it is appetizer basically. It's an aromatic stimulant. It is a carminative. Carminative meaning it expels gas from the stomach. It's a condiment and a flavoring agent too. and it is also prescribed in dyspepsia, flatulent choline. It acts as an adjunct to many tonic and stimulating remedies, and it is also used for painful affections. Affection here is disease of the stomach, cold, cough and asthma. It is also used to treat sore throat, hoarseness and loss of voice. Just you remember, your grandparents would have told you, if you have a sore throat or hoarseness or if your voice is lost, they'll tell you to just chew a piece of ginger. So it has got a wide use over here. It's coming to adulterants. So ginger is mainly adulterated with exhausted ginger. Exhausted ginger means what? So the ginger from which the constituents are already removed. So if you just subject it to steam distillation, the main components, volatile oil, comes out. Okay? And then this is replaced. So you will not be knowing it unless and until you do these tests. You can, how do you find out the adulterated ginger? Usually it will be a more shrunken and it will be darker in color. And you can actually determine it by performing the water-soluble ash value or by determining the volatile oil content or by finding out the extractive values, that is alcohol-soluble and water-soluble extractive values. Usually in these exhausted ginger, these values will be reduced because already the most important constituents would be removed. So the last one, coming to the commercial products available, you have dehydrated ginger flakes, ginger candy, ginger powder, ginger oil, ginger mouthwash and many more. Now dehydrated ginger flakes, it is seen as a spice ingredient. So in cooking, these flakes are used. Ginger candy, these are thinly sliced and it is coated in sugar syrup. And you can also see ginger flavors in strepsils and all. So it basically acts as a carminative. To reduce, it's a carminative and also it is used as a demulcent where it soothes your throat. And ginger powder, it prevents nausea. So when a vomiting sensation is there, just this powder can be just taken with a little honey. Ginger oil, now this can be extracted from ginger rhizome and this oil, a drop of it can be put to hot water and you can just sip it so that it basically acts as a carminative. So as we know, ginger is a flavoring agent. It is widely used in mouthwashes. It gives a good flavor to the mouth. Ginger beverages. I hope all of you in your lifetime you would have tasted ginger tea and you would have definitely liked it. So it is very good for health and now it builds up your immunity as well. So ginger beverages are used. Ginger tea is available. Ginger liquor is also available. And medicinally, you can see ginger capsules where this is used as a stomachic. Stomachic in the sense it is an appetizer. So I hope all of you have understood the session. And at the end of this session, you have learned the following. You came to know the synonym of ginger, its biological source, with family, its geographical source, the cultivation, collection and storage part of ginger, its morphology, description based on color, odor, taste, shape, size and extra features. Microscopy of ginger, it can be the transverse section or the study of powder microscopy, and study of important chemical constituents, basically the volatile oils and resins, uses of ginger, the adulterants and substitutes used, and various commercial products of ginger. So I hope the session was interesting. Thank you.